sun is really coming through, isn't it?
Probably not a bad idea, just... Okay, maybe not.
Isn't that a wonderful way to get our morning started?
Yes.
There is a strange phenomenon outside occurring. I don't know what to call it, but it's nice. Sunshine, yes. Well, good morning and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Spokane, where our mission is to join together to create a nourishing liberal religious home and to champion justice, diversity, and environmental stewardship in our wider world. Or as we say in short, to create community, find meaning, and work for justice. I want to begin as usual by welcoming all of you to this space, all of your uniqueness, your unique beliefs, your background, your lifestyle, your experiences, your differences, all that helps make you who you are is welcome here this morning. And this includes those of you who are joining us in person. Those of you who are joining us for the first time, you're equally as welcome. And the many of you who are streaming with us from home, it's so good to have you. Incidentally, last week we had just record-breaking numbers between the in-person folks and the folks streaming and the folks Zooming. We had over 500 last Sunday. So yeah, we know that you're there, and we don't get to necessarily see you, but we sure are glad that you're here with us. So thanks to everyone for being part of the community wherever you're at this morning. I also want to give you one reminder of our new member orientation happening at 12:30, from 12:30 to 2. After this service is over with, for those, it's especially for those who might be considering formally joining the church to become members. We'll talk a bit about Unitarian Universalist history, as well as our church history, and answer any other questions you might have. But it's also pretty interesting. If you just want to learn a little bit more about us, you'd be welcome to attend. And it's going to be in person here in the sanctuary. It's also going to be live streamed, and there'll be a Zoom meeting. So if you want to join us via Zoom and have any particular questions, we'll try to get to those as well. Okay, that's the only announcement I have for now, so why don't we take a few moments to greet one another this morning. Those of you who are in the room, of course, can stand up, take a short walk maybe, and say hi to somebody you know, and maybe meet somebody you haven't known. If you are joining us for the first time visiting, don't be shy. All right, and there'll be more time for visiting with one another during our coffee period following the service, so please stick around for that. But we are going to move forward now by lighting our chalice, the symbol of our faith, the symbol of our unity and our solidarity, of our openness and our inclusion, of our community and our individual uniqueness. May this small flame be our offering of warmth to those who are cold and alone, and a light to those in darkness. May it be a flame that ignites justice in our world and a beacon of hope to those in need. And may it reflect at least a spark of truth wherever truth has been lost, and cast a healthy shadow of doubt wherever it's been found.
Our opening words this morning are from Emily Dickinson. Hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. And sweetest in the gale is heard, and sore must be the storm that could abash the little bird that kept so many warm. I've heard it in the chillest land and on the strangest sea, yet never in extremity it asked a crumb of me.
Well, we're going to start your singing this morning with a song that was really written for Misa Gaia by the Paul Winter Consort. And it's in our hymnal. It's called For the Earth Forever Turning, 163. Please stand as you're willing and able.
We are now going to kindle our candles of care for those who are most on our hearts and minds this morning. And we begin, as we have been for many months now, kindling a candle for the people of Ukraine and the rest of that region of the world that are being most impacted by the unnecessary violence and destruction and terror going on there. Let's too take a moment of silence on behalf of others that you might be thinking of, and as always, you're welcome to name them aloud at this time if you'd like. Those named aloud and those embraced in our silence and all those who are suffering in our world at this hour, we hold in our community with compassion. And we now gratefully give and receive this morning's offering, which helps sustain this community and our mission to the larger world. Thanks again. Beautiful music to have this morning. It's now time for our story, for time for all ages, I should say. So if you would like to come forward and help us dust mop the floor with your pants, you can do that. I make it sound appealing, don't I? Yeah. Or you can stay right where you're at. Totally up to you. Here comes the story. Can you see it and hear it from back there? Does that work for you? Yeah, it'll work. Okay, all right. Well, Christmas just so happens, and New Year's actually both fall on a Sunday this year. And so we, unlike a lot of churches that will have a booming attendance, don't expect we will. So we're not going to have services on those Sundays, and I'm going to be out of the pulpit next week, so this I won't see you after today until next year. And so I do love the Christmas holiday, and I wrote the North Pole a letter recently and said, actually I emailed him, to taking emails now, and said, hey, any chance Santa Claus could come a little early to say hi? So I believe Santa's right under the pulpit here, so let me check, okay? Hey, what have we here? Ho, ho, ho! Well, this must be him now. Ho, 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 boys and girls! Merry Christmas! Wow, are you really Santa Claus? Well, don't you recognize my big red hat? I do. And my white beard? I see your white beard. And my jolly laugh. Ho, ho, ho! But Santa, what big ears you have? Well, the better to hear your Christmas wishes with. I see. And what big eyes you have. Well, the better to see if you're the naughty or nice. True. And Santa, what a big nose you have. Well, that's not very nice. I'm putting you on the naughty list. Okay. Well, I probably deserve it. So, you know, you're not actually fooling anybody, is he? This is not Santa Claus. We know who you are. Who is this? Mickey Mouse. Mickey Mouse, of course. What are you doing here, and why? Where is Santa Claus?
Well, you see, Santa Claus is very dizzy this time of the year, so he asked me to come and stand in for him.
He did? Well, that's understandable that he's busy, but why you?
Well, because I'm one of Santa's helpers.
You are one of Santa's helpers?
Sure. Santa has lots of helpers.
Does he?
How else do you think he gets all those presents delivered on Christmas morning?
Well, I assumed it was because he starts at the International Dateline at midnight on December 24th and travels backward against the Earth's rotation, which ends up giving him 48 hours to get the job done.
No, sirree, it's because of all us helpers.
Well, that's good to know, but it's still a big job. So how many helpers does Santa Claus have?
Well, everyone who celebrates Christmas is one of Santa's helpers.
Everyone who celebrates Christmas is one of Santa's helpers? That's a lot of helpers.
It sure is.
Well, why does he need so many helpers to give us gifts? I mean, he has a magic sleigh, flying reindeer, lots of toy-making elves in the North Pole.
Well, because it isn't about Christmas, isn't about Santa Claus giving us gifts.
It's not.
It's about us giving each other by sharing kindness and friendship throughout the entire year.
I see. I never really thought about that before, Mickey. But you're right. Every one of us is like Santa Claus when we're kind to each other, do you think? Yeah. Okay.
Well, you're darn tootin'.
Well, does this mean that you're going to even give Donald Duck a Christmas present? I know you two don't always get along.
I sure am. I've already gotten in his gift.
Oh, what is it?
A new raincoat.
A new raincoat. You're getting a duck a raincoat. Isn't the whole point of the saying like water off a duck's back because ducks don't get wet?
That's true. But nice do, and I might want to borrow it sometime.
Okay, well, that's a very interesting gift to give to Donald Duck, but I'm sure he's going to like it. So thanks for being one of Santa Claus's helpers and stopping by to remind us of what Christmas is really about, being kind to one another every day of the year, right? Okay.
You said it, and neither did peace on earth and goodwill toward all.
Thank you. Merry Christmas, Mickey.
Merry Christmas, everyone.
It's now a time in our service for us to move into a meditation, and I invite you to reflect on these words from Robert Fulghum. Peace is not something you wish for. It is something you make, something you are, something you do, and something you give away.
By the way, I want to thank Lynn Janishian for filling in as our lay leader today. Candace Schmidt was scheduled to be our lay leader, and she wasn't feeling well, so she wisely stayed home, but was kind enough to send us the wonderful readings that she picked out, and Lynn was kind enough to say, I'll take it on today. So thank you very much. These are the words of Howard Thurman. When the song of angels is stilled, when the star in the sky is gone, when the kings and princes are home, when the shepherds are back with their flock, the work of Christmas begins. To find the lost, to heal the broken, to feed the hungry, to release the prisoner, to rebuild the nations, to bring peace among the brothers, to make music in the heart.
This piece called Solstice has intentional pauses. I invite you to breathe with us.
Well, now I know why the sun has showed up this morning. Perfect timing. From the vantage point of millennia, not centuries, historian Yuval Harari says it becomes crystal clear that history is moving relentlessly toward unity. By relentlessly, he means it's obvious, unstoppable, and an exponential advance toward becoming one global human society. And that sounds great, especially during the holiday season when so many around the world are contemplating peace on earth and goodwill toward all. It should be particularly welcome information for Unitarian Universalists who ought to be working towards such unity all year long. One of our seven principles, the principles we're so fond of, our sixth principle, is the goal of world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all. It's not a principle that we hear or talk much about, as relatively easy as it is to remember, the goal of world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all. My guess this is so because for many of us, it seems to be more of a pipe dream than a possibility. When we look at the continued state of our world today, world community sounds like a far off, if not lofty, goal at best. Barely more than two decades ago, it seemed the world was moving into a promising new era, coinciding with a brand new millennium. The computer age had only just begun, and many of us were unduly worried that the turning of the clock on New Year's Day was going to bring this modern marvel and all of its promise to a sudden halt, resulting in technological shutdown and financial ruin. I never believed it, by the way. But a lot of people did. Remember Y2K? We called it year 2000. But the technological shutdown and financial ruin never happened. Our computers kept working, and so did everything else, pretty much the way it always had. And maybe that's the real misfortune of Y2K, that within just a few months of the new millennium, we would find the 21st century to be as but a continuation of the same patterns, problems, conflicts, and injustices we'd experienced toward the end of the 20th. Less than 2 years in, one of the worst terrorist attacks in U.S. history occurred, of course, on September 11th, 2001. As horrific as it was, it prompted global compassion and a rare moment of global unity and support for our disheartened nation. A French newspaper declared, "We are all Americans now." And rather than accepting such extraordinary goodwill and an international commitment to find those responsible, the U.S. government used the tragedy to further its own global agenda by going after Saddam Hussein and seizing control of Iraq's oil supply. Iraq, of course, had nothing to do with the attacks of 9/11, and as UN inspectors repeatedly insisted, we're not amassing weapons of mass destruction, as the Bush administration falsely claimed to justify its unprecedented preemptive strike against a country that had done nothing to us. Additionally, in the wake of those attacks, after all flights had been grounded in the U.S., the Bush administration allowed officials from Saudi Arabia to secretly fly out of the U.S., even though theirs was the country most of the terrorists responsible for 9/11 were known to have been from. But many Americans simply didn't care who was actually responsible for the attacks, so long as we reestablished our sense of dominance and superiority by proving that we can invade and shoot and bomb and kill somebody, anybody. I'm still bitter about it. Can you tell? But my point now is that less than 2 years into what should have been the beginning of a new age of global peace and prosperity, we were still behaving like violent brutes with no regard for the lives of those outside of our own tribes and no sense of connection to them or responsibility for their welfare. During the past 23 years, despite all our advances, it seems the human family is growing further apart, not closer. According to Freedom House, our nation's oldest nonpartisan organization devoted to promoting and defending democracy around the world, there have been 16 years of consecutive decline in global freedom. Its 2022 report on the global expansion of authoritarianism says a total of 60 countries suffered declines over the past year, while only 25 improved. As of today, some 38% of the global population live in not free countries, the highest proportion since 1997. Since Y2K, that is, the world has become less free than it was in the 20th century. A major reason for this, the report says, is that in countries with long-established democracies, internal forces have exploited the shortcomings in their systems, distorting national politics to promote hatred, violence, and unbridled power. And we know how that goes. In our own country, populist Donald Trump, the most unqualified and authoritarian personality ever to hold the office, in my opinion, became president of the United States. And after later refusing to concede his loss to Joe Biden and facilitate a peaceful transfer of power, helped to instigate a raid on the state capitol and, as many believe, an attempt to overthrow the U.S. government on January 6, 2020. And not so long ago, about the time Trump was being elected in the U.S. on a nationalistic promise to make America great again, a slim majority of British voters made the xenophobic decision to leave the European Union they had been part of since 1973. Voting to leave the world economy, especially in the UK, which is next door to so many international neighbors that it depends upon, has proven harder to accomplish than many Brexiters understood. Withdrawing from today's global economy is not possible in practice. Not for the UK, not for Russia, not for any of us. Still, the wish of so many to retreat into nationalism, into isolationism, has been a troubling trend during just the first years of the 21st century. In addition to what's happening on the national and international levels, it appears we are becoming more divided as individuals. The Occupy movement that began on Wall Street in 2011 to protest the economic divide between the wealthiest top 1% and the rest of us quickly spread to ongoing protests in over 600 cities across the U.S. and nearly 1,000 cities in 82 other countries. Identity politics and so-called woke ideology on the extreme left has also worked to further segregate and divide the human family, based upon the very differences we have been arguing for decades shouldn't matter. Race and gender and sexuality and nationality and religion, class and so on. And today, as another new year is upon us, we are watching Russian dictator Vladimir Putin oversee the brutal destruction of his neighboring country and the killing and torment of Ukrainian civilians because he wants to recreate the glory days of his youth by reestablishing an Eastern Bloc that can be kept apart from the West with a new Cold War and an imaginary Iron Curtain. Considering all of this, it's difficult to imagine that there can be any truth to Harari's crystal clear claim that history is moving relentlessly towards unity. Even so, our sixth principle, the goal of world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all, is still my favorite of the seven. And I don't consider it a pipe dream that will never come true. Not only do I believe it is possible, I believe that it is inevitable, and I believe that it is happening right now. just as relentlessly as Harari says. And before explaining why I think so, let me back up a little and say a little bit more about how things look from his bird's eye view of history. 12,000 years ago, there were unknown thousands of human communities living on Earth, few of which knew the others even existed. Only 2,000 years ago, the number of these dwarf worlds, as Harari calls them, had shrunk to just hundreds or maybe a couple of thousand at most. Only 500 years ago, he says, 90% of humans lived in a single mega world, the world of Afro-Asia, and the other 10% lived in but four distinct societies, the Mesoamerican, the Andean, the Australian, and the Oceanic. And all of this is what leads Harari to conclude that over the millennia, small, simple cultures gradually coalesce into bigger and more complex civilizations, so that the world contains fewer and fewer megacultures, each of which is bigger and more complex. Today, this shift to one global community is happening faster than ever, even though it's not something that our global leaders, the heads of our dying nation states, ever say much about. Perhaps they're loath to admit it. Perhaps they're unaware that it's happening, like a lot of us. There are officially only 195 countries in the world today. One of those is the Catholic Church. So let's say 194, which isn't very many considering how many human communities there were 12,000 years ago. If history continues moving relentlessly toward unity, as Harari predicts, there will soon be only one human community. Until relatively recently, and only since the 19th century, nations have been the containers of human societies, the members of which have identified mostly with their nationalities, the country in which they were born, and the thing to which they feel they most belong. Rather than seeing ourselves as earthlings or as a species, we see ourselves as Americans and Canadians and Russians and Chinese and French, English, Cubans, Africans, Iranians, Haitians, or any one of another 185 nationalities. Yet that which most people on the planet share in common, no matter where we are from, is our desire to come together. In 1900, little more than a century ago, only 5% of the global population lived in cities. Only 5%. 50 years later, it was 30%. And in 2007, only 16 years ago, half the world's population lived in cities. In the U.S., 83% of us already live in cities. And by 2050, the United Nations predicts 68% of the world will live in cities. Even more recently, we've seen the rise of megacities, cities that have over 10 million inhabitants. The U.S. is home to two of them. Can you guess what they are? What is it? New York and L.A. Thank you. Yep. New York and L.A. So L.A. has 12.5 million residents. That's the tiny one. New York has 18.9 million. With 21.6 million, Mexico City is the largest megacity in North America and one of the largest in the world, but still small compared to, you know, Tokyo. Oh my gosh. You can leave. You're dismissed. You've already heard this number. No, good for you. That's right. And so with more than 37.5 million inhabitants, Japan has the largest megacity in the world. Keep in mind that in 1950, Tokyo and New York were the only megacities on the planet. And the third, Mexico City, wasn't added until 1975. Yet today, there are 32 megacities with nine more just a few hundred thousand citizens away from becoming so. Right? Meaning nine more with well over 9 million citizens. It's an astonishing realization that as divided as we feel the world is, the vast majority of us are moving closer together. Relentlessly moving from hundreds of thousands of rural communities into a few thousand small cities, into less than 1,000 major cities, then into only a few dozen mega cities. And as this trend continues, and the economies of cities become greater than many nations, greater than the nations they are even in, nation states are becoming less significant, and so are our national identities. Again, as Yuval Harari says, as the 21st century unfolds, nationalism is fast losing ground. This may come as a surprise to some, but the age of the nation state has been a relatively short one to begin with, right? The age in which we identified with our country has been relatively short. In the 1944 book, The Idea of Nationalism, Hans Kohn reminds us, nationalism, as we understand it, is not older than the second half of the 18th century. That's 175 years ago. So what we take for granted today is itself a relatively new phenomenon. Prior to this, individual identity was more likely to be tied up with one's religion, or maybe the king one pledged their devotion to, or maybe their village or their tribe to which one belonged. Today we are poised, out of necessity, if nothing else, to make another change regarding our identities, regarding how we see ourselves. This is so because nationalism doesn't make as much sense as it once did. Not in today's world. How can we isolate ourselves from the world when we share so much in common? Global community, global problems, and global awareness of each other. How can we seek our own national interests? How can we want to make America great again at the expense of other nations when we know we are so connected to them? Today, as Harari says, almost all humans share the same geopolitical system, the same economic system, the same legal system, and the same scientific system. Today, we have global businesses, global employers, global investors, global entertainment, just watch Netflix, a global supply chain, an international space station, a world wide web, as well as planetary challenges like global warming and global pandemics that require a global response for us to resolve. All of this helps us understand why then there has been so much chaos and conflict in the world during these past 23 years? Because we are undergoing changes in which our old governments and identities don't work and don't make much sense anymore. But we haven't yet established the global rules and systems necessary for us to function well in this new reality. We are still thinking like nationalists, even though we have all become globalists. As such, we need global rules that grant and guarantee basic human rights to every citizen in the world, focusing on human welfare and individual unfolding everywhere, regardless of their nationality or other identities that are secondary to the common humanity that we all share, to our identity as an interplanetary species. The brotherhood and sisterhood of mankind, In his book, One World, The Ethics of Globalization, philosopher Peter Singer says, until recently, such thoughts have been the dreams of idealists, devoid of practical impact on the hard realities of a world of nation states. But now we are beginning to live in a global community. In fact, now we live in a global community. Fearful of change and uncertainty, however, too many of us want to retreat into the old patterns and identities that keep us apart, that keep us feeling safe. This explains the decline of freedom that we've seen the past few years and the rise of authoritarianism, and authoritarians pointlessly promising to hold the line between their particular nations and the rest of the world, as if that were possible. It also explains the rise of identity politics and identitarianism on the left, based on old segregationist ideas that claim race and gender and sexuality and nationality and the like make us so different from each other that we can't possibly relate to each other, and that it is in fact dangerous and harmful to be around each other. Does that make sense in a world where tens of millions of us are moving into cities together? Of course not. It's a dead end. Identitarianism is a dead end. Yet when there are more people living together in some cities than there are in many countries in the world, it's even absurd. These backward, fearful, divisive mindsets. And this is the point, that the unnecessary suffering and conflict that we have experienced at the beginning of this new age, this new millennium, are themselves proof that the new age is upon us. Like any dramatic change, it is going to be met with resistance, especially until we establish the new and necessary ways of living and working together and develop a mindset that understands, accepts, and embraces this new global reality. We are in a moment of unfamiliar and uncertain upheaval as one world passes and as another is still emerging. We are a generation of tweeners. So now it is not the time to sink into helplessness and hopelessness, or to retreat into old authoritarian patterns of thinking and behavior, whether as nations or as individuals. Now is the time to remain calm and reassuring and hopeful and aware of what is really happening. As Unitarians, we should be well suited to lead the way, because the humanistic ethic that must become central in this new age of global community, right, because we're identifying now as human beings, primarily as human beings as a species, and world unity is something that we have been striving for since our religion began. The humanistic ethic, as you often hear me say, is based on the imperative that everything we do must be for the good of humanity and individual unfolding, individual growth. It is not a nationalistic ethic. It can't be a nationalistic ethic that suggests everything we do must be only for the good of our country and our countrymen. That is anti-humanism. Nor only for our race or our gender or our religion or any other identity. It is based on the idea once expressed so perfectly by Chief Joseph of the Nez Perce that the earth is the mother of all people and all people should have equal rights upon it. Hey, that's pretty simple. We're all earthlings, and therefore we should all enjoy the same rights. It was also expressed in the United Nations 1948 Universal Declaration of Human Rights that begins by recognizing the inherent dignity and of the equal and inalienable rights of all members of the human family as the foundation of freedom, justice, and peace in the world. If we are going to have freedom, justice, and peace in the world, then we have to have universal basic rights for every person on the planet. And these rights, the Declaration says, include freedom of speech and belief and freedom from fear and want, the right to life, liberty, and security of person, freedom from slavery and servitude in all their forms, the right to be recognized everywhere as a person before the law, equal protection of the law, fair trials, impartial tribunals, and to be considered innocent until proven guilty, the right to be free of the kind of arbitrary attacks against one's character that we're now actually finding on social media, the freedom of movement and the right to freely leave and return to one's country, and I believe to all countries, the right to marry or not to marry, to own property, to choose one's religion or to reject it, to be peacefully assemble, to vote, to access public services, to choose one's work, to equal pay, to form unions, to leisure, vacations, and paid holidays, to education, and the right to basic needs, including food, clothing, housing, medical care, and necessary social services like Social Security in the event of unemployment or sickness or disability or widowhood or old age. 1948, it's all there. This declaration was envisioned 75 years ago, but its time has finally come because it is the only possible way of successfully and peacefully being together in our new global community. Yet it represents a radical change in how we do things, in how we must come to think about ourselves and the world, about how we come to think about ourselves and our relationships to the whole wide world. So as we consider all the difficulties and conflict in the world at the start of this century, let us look toward its end with hope that history really is moving relentlessly toward unity, and that principle we claim to hold dear but scarcely mention because we can scarce believe it might ever come true, is coming true, faster and surer than we could have imagined, the goal of world community, with peace, liberty, and justice for all. May it be so.
We're going to close the day with a song that you, I think, all know. It's Imagine by John Lennon. You can access words on the screen, or it's also as an insert in your order of service. Please rise as you're willing and able. Imagine there's no countries. It isn't hard to do. Nothing to kill or die for, and no religion too. Imagine all the people living life in peace. Oh, you may say I'm a dreamer, but I'm not the only one. I hope someday you'll join us, and the world will be as one. Imagine no possessions. I wonder.
Benediction today is an anonymous quote. Peace. It does not mean to be in a place where there is no noise, trouble, or hard work. It means to be in the midst of those things and still be calm in your heart. Amen. Blessed be. Salam alaikum and shalom.
Yeah.